Welcome to Causes TV, which comes to you from the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences of the University of the District of Columbia. It is my pleasure to welcome you to today's lecture in our series of occasional lecture topics.
So good afternoon and welcome to this first graduate research seminar of the spring semester 2021. We're already in the first week of classes, believe it or not, fast and furious as things go. As most of you know, my name is Sabina O'Hara and I serve as the director of the PhD program in urban leadership and entrepreneurship. And this program really, I think, meets the needs and interests of all of our students, whether you are in the sustainability or in the policy or in the entrepreneurship track of the program. It is my distinct pleasure to introduce Glenn Marie Lange. You've seen her short bio that we've posted. She has been with the World Bank,
12 years,
hard to believe, Glenn Marie, it's been that long. And before that, you taught at New Jersey Institute of Technology. You were at NYU working with a very famous person, namely the late Nobel recipient.
Vasily Leontief.
Sorry for jumping in. Yes, absolutely. Thank you for helping me out here. You got your own PhD from the New School.
From NYU.
Okay. Yep. Okay, great. And Glenn Marie and I have known each other. So here comes the private addition to the official bio. Glenn Marie is an economist, as you know from her bio, who has worked on natural resource accounting and assessing the natural resources of countries, which is an important field within ecological economics. And so we've known each other for a lot of years.
Almost 30 years, I was just
Almost 30 years. And in fact, when we both were lowly assistant professors, we used to bunk together, right, at these conferences.
I know we did, yeah.
That we would attend. And we had great fun. One time we were in Tunisia for an ecological economics conference.
Right. Yeah.
And backpacked it and took a train down into the desert area from Sousse on south into the desert, the edge of the desert in Tunisia. So we've known each other for a long time. Every time I send you a family update letter, Glenn Marie, you are astounded how old my sons now look, right?
I know.
You knew them as little tykes. So it's a real pleasure, both on a professional and a personal level, that you are able to do this seminar with us today. So without any further ado, I'm going to turn things over to you.
Okay, very good. It's going to take a moment to get to my screen, the slideshow view. Hopefully it will come quickly. I really want to say I admire all of you so much for, trying to persist with this remote learning, this crazy stuff that's going on. And, we're all going to learn a lot from you and your experience. So, I really admire all that you're doing. Okay, I see most of you are very focused on urban issues, community development, things like this. And for my work, I'm going to ask you to take a step back and think about a larger national level, how we look at sustainability at a national level. And so I'm going to tell you a little bit about our ongoing work program called the Changing Wealth of Nations. And I'll have some results that we published in 2018, although we're in the process of finalizing an update. So the idea behind this is that it's really clear if you're a business and you're going out there trying to raise money, or if you're a household and you want to get a mortgage loan, something like that, you have to go to people who might borrow, lend you money and show them what your income is, of course, but also what your net worth, your assets minus liabilities. And that makes a lot of sense because, you know, if you're a business, you sell off all your assets and your income looks great, but that's only 1 year. And that's not a feasible strategy for long-term financial health. So this all makes sense, except the odd thing is when we look at countries, how what the nation reports on its economic status, the only information that we have is about GDP. I'm sure most of you have heard this. I know this is a very economics kind of approach, and not all of you may have an economics background, but hopefully you've at least heard of GDP, gross domestic product. When it goes up, things are good. When it goes down, things are bad. Fine, that's our national income, but it tells us nothing about the underlying asset base that's needed to generate that income. We might have growing income, but declining asset base. And that means a problem for the long term. So the initial objective of our program on the changing wealth of nations is to provide a more comprehensive assessment of how a country is doing economically and what its progress is over time. And we do that by looking at wealth, and particularly wealth per capita, as we'll see. Okay, so what does that look like and what do our accounts look like? Well, you know, one of the things that's very important in economic analysis is number one, that you have a time series because you want to see how are things changing over time. If you have a figure just for this year or just today or this month, is it good? Is it bad? Well, who knows? Is it better than last year? Is it better than 10, 20 years ago? Those are some of the issues that we need to understand when we're trying to figure out if we're going in the right direction. And that's whether it's a municipality, whether it's a nation, whether it's the global economy. Are we headed in the right direction? So we need a time series. So we have always built this starting in 1995. And the data I'm going to show you cover from 1995 to 2014. We have 20 years worth of data. The other thing that's important, particularly when we're talking at the national level, is to look at how other countries are doing. I do a lot of work in many, many different countries in the world. And when we come up with whatever it is that we're looking at, some indicators, some proposals for work, whatever it is, everyone wants to know, well, what are my neighbors doing? Have they started it already? Are they doing better than me? Are they doing worse than me? And sometimes you may have seen some places, I know my family's home in Rhode Island gets this quarterly energy report that says, this is how much energy you've used, but your neighbors have used this much energy. And maybe it's more, maybe it's less. But it's for some of you who are interested in behavioral economics, you may have come across this, that it's a useful spur to action to see how you do compared to your neighbors. So we have a time series of 20 years of data and growing, and we cover 141 countries, and that's also increasing so that we can deal with both of these issues. If you look at the bottom set of rows here, that's telling us what we're measuring in wealth. So it's really important if we're trying to connect wealth with economic well-being and development that we take a broad view, a comprehensive view of all the assets. So well, often when people talk about capital, they're just thinking about produced capital. That's the machinery, equipment, buildings, structures, infrastructure, urban land, those kinds of things. But if we're really going to understand development and long-term sustainability, we have to consider natural capital. And there we have two really different categories. One is the non-renewable, the fossil fuels and minerals, and the other is the renewables. Agricultural land, forests and their ecosystems, protected areas, and others that we're only incorporating now. With energy and minerals, if you extract them, if you use them, then they're gone. They're non-renewable, they're depletable. So managing them for development can be quite different from our renewable natural capital. Agricultural land, forests, mangroves, fisheries, if you manage them sustainably, they can provide benefits forever. So the challenges for managing these different assets is quite different. Then we have human capital. And as you'll see, this is the most important component of wealth. And here we're able to distinguish male and female, employed and self-employed. Then there's another little category there called net foreign assets, which is small, but if you're following a lot of the global discussions about the potential economic long-term impact of the COVID pandemic, you'll see one of the things that keeps getting coming up is, what about the levels of debt? How are we going to manage the levels of debt? So keeping track of that is also important. I mentioned here some of the things that are missing, and many of these we're actually going to be including in our next round. So we build this, we build these accounts, and we see this as the supporting national income or GDP, which leads to long-term prosperity and well-being. A caveat before we go on, we measure this in monetary units. We have underlying physical data, but these are monetary values, financial values of assets. And they do not tell the whole story. We would like to see this used together with things like natural capital, critical natural capital, and social capital that covers a wide range of issues, from equity to the quality of our institutions, policies, and so on. So this is a work in progress, and bringing all these together in a framework to understand better how countries are doing and where they're going over time is what we're working on. So let me go and start to tell you what we see when we pulled all this data together. The first thing we looked at was how did it grow globally? What's our global condition? And global wealth from 95 to 2014 increased by 66%. Okay, how did the different regions do? Well, the one thing that really stands out is East Asia and the Pacific. Its share grew from 20% to 26%. I don't know, you know, how much you folks might be interested in this or follow this, but not surprisingly, China accounts for a major portion of that increased share. On the other hand, the share of North America, Europe, and Central Asia declined from 75% to 65%. And that's because typically, our low and middle income countries are growing, if well managed, they're growing faster than the high income countries that dominate Europe and North America. So this is what we want to see, something called convergence in economics, where the lower ones catch up with the ones that have had more time to build their economies. One of the things that's a little troubling is that sub-Saharan Africa's share did not change. Its share of global wealth didn't change. But it's a very mixed picture, as we will see as we go along. Very large number of countries in sub-Saharan Africa, and they've had very different performance. Okay. So let's look then just at the low and middle income countries. These are the countries I work for the World Bank. These are the countries we really focus on. We need a global picture, but we're not too worried about what's happening in most of the high income countries. Let them take care of themselves. So on the left-hand side, we see the shares of global wealth. The blue bar is 1995. The orange one is 2014. And we see that basically they've all increased over time, as we saw. But China, my God, it more than, well, just about doubled. Yeah, more than doubled. So here we do see how important China has been to the development of our low and middle income countries. On the right-hand side, we identify the major countries in the low and middle income countries. Of those, China accounted for almost half of global wealth. So it's a very important player. And it's important, you know, if you're thinking this from about this from research methods, one of the things that you want to do is when you're looking at a bunch of data, see where the big ones are and the small ones are. Where are the outliers? And pull them out, because if you just look at it all together, China, because it dominates, may really end up telling the whole story. So unless you pull it out and look at some of these others, you won't get that nuanced view of what's happening across all the countries that we're concerned with. So now we come to how we're starting to look at sustainability, percent change in wealth per capita. Now we've just moved. Before this slide, we've just been looking at total wealth. We don't adjust for population. We said that China had a very large share of wealth, but it's also got a big share of the world's population. So what about its per capita wealth? And this is something that we really care about, because we care about what's available, the stock of assets available for each person to generate income. So we have grouped these according to how fast they have grown or whether they've declined or not. The light and dark green countries are countries where wealth per capita grew at least 50%. And we see that is mostly in Asia, East Asia and South Asia. China and India, for example, stand out, but so does Vietnam here. We see Latin America, some countries like Chile and Peru stand out. We see a few countries also in Africa, Mozambique, Rwanda, Ethiopia. These are countries where wealth per capita has grown significantly. The more tan or pale yellow ones, we have positive growth, but not very rapid. And North America, Russia, much of Latin America, some African countries, some European countries. Then we have the countries that we're really a little bit concerned about. You know, if they're growing, we say, okay, that's good. But when the countries are sort of stagnating or even declining in wealth per capita, you know, that's like a warning sign. You know, we really have to take a look and see what's going on here and, you know, what might be different. So what are some of the reasons in some of the countries here? Well, one of the big problems for countries is when they're in social conflict, civil unrest. So what we call fragile conflict states. For example, Zimbabwe, Madagascar, you can't see it too well here, but Lebanon is also there. And Lebanon is an interesting case because they have at this time had accommodated a huge number of refugees from Syria. So in a sense, they are providing a global public good by hosting refugees. And that, unfortunately, then drives down their change in wealth per capita. But we also have some interesting cases, like some of the European countries that were really hard hit by the financial crisis in 2008-2009. Greece, Portugal, Spain, for example, Turkey, they have all been very hard hit by the financial crisis. Mexico is also there, and they're another interesting case because there it's more a problem of very, very slow wage growth and just a lack of investment. So what we see is we can look at countries and see, are they doing well, really well? Are they doing okay? Or maybe are they in trouble? But if we look at those that are in trouble, we see it's for a wide range of reasons. Okay, let's go on here. So I want to come back to this issue of per capita wealth and total wealth, because population growth is a very important factor here. If we look at this figure here, the light blue bars tell us how much total wealth increased. Basically, that's investment in all the different assets over those 20 years. The dark blue bar within is total wealth per capita. What's the difference? It's adjusted for population growth. So if you look at on the left-hand side of this figure, low-income countries, lower middle income countries, they invested about the same amount overall. They increased their wealth by roughly 100%. They did better than high income non-OECD, OECD and high income OECD countries. They did better than the world at large, doubling their investment, doubling their wealth, while the global wealth increased only 66%. But now let's look at that dark bar. The low income countries typically have very high population growth rates. So even though it did well in accumulating assets and building its wealth, building its assets, it didn't do enough to keep up with population growth. If you've got rapid population growth, you've got to invest rapidly too, to reap that demographic dividend, as it's called. Look at the middle one, the upper middle income. Upper middle income is where China is situated. And the interesting thing about China is not only is it a very fast and rapid investor building wealth, but they also have a slow, actually declining population. So it heavily influences this figure here. Okay, let me go on now. What does this tell us about the process of development and wealth? How are these two associated? So this is important, and I know none of you mentioned that you were macroeconomists, but this is kind of a macroeconomic perspective on things. So every country and people who are managing it, whether it's your Treasury Department or Ministry of Finance, Planning, whatever, they look at this and say, well, is current GDP sustainable, or are we liquidating our capital? How much does this nation need to save versus consume? And then what assets do we need to invest in? So if we look across each one of these columns, the bars show our different categories of assets: produced capital, the infrastructure, machinery, equipment, natural capital, the energy and fossil fuels, but also agriculture, forests, and so on, and then human capital all the way on the right. So let's start with that top row, low-income countries. What we see is that produced capital accounts for 14% of their wealth. Natural capital, 47%. It's the largest component of wealth in low-income countries. And human capital close behind at 41%. Before we go into that in more detail, let's go all the way down, not to world, but one above it, the high income OECD countries. Produced capital, our infrastructure, et cetera, 28%, twice what it is as a share in low income countries. Natural capital is much less, only 3% compared to 47% in low income countries. And human capital is 70%. By far the largest component. So what we see over time is that initially all societies don't have any produced capital. No society is set up with infrastructure, with roads, with communication, with buildings, very rudimentary. Human capital, in terms of the education, the skills that can be put to productive use, is also relatively low. But what do countries have? They've got lots of natural capital. It's not surprising that our low-income countries are predominantly agricultural countries. Agriculture looms large in the well-being of these countries. So what happens over time is that we leverage the natural capital, which is abundant, which we have lots of, relatively speaking, to build the scarce missing capital. We leverage that to build more infrastructure. We leverage it to educate our populations and build human capital. So what we see over time is that the share of produced capital increases, the share of human capital increases, and the share of natural capital becomes smaller. As we'll see, it's not that it's unimportant, but that we're adding other kinds of capital to this base of natural capital. If anyone has questions, I mean, you know, this is a really weird situation where I can't see anyone or anyone's responses. So I don't know if, like, you know, people are like going way off and saying, I don't know what this is. Or, you know, if you have questions, just, you know, shout out and we'll deal with them as we go along.
Yeah. And I'll also try to monitor the chat if you want to put something in the chat box.
Yeah. Okay, so let's look closer at the two ends here, human capital as a driver of development and then natural capital. Okay, this is what we see. Low-income countries, very small share. So the bars tell us what the share of total wealth is. The line tells us the absolute value per capita, right? So low-income. Very low share, very small share of total wealth. On a per capita basis, we look over on the right-hand side and we see it's about 300,000 per person. If we go up to high income OECD, 70% of wealth and $500,000 per person, much, much higher. So this is where we see with human capital very clearly how countries invest in education to build their human capital, and it really does become extremely important. However, aging of population, slow wage growth, due to both, some is due to technological factors, but a lot is due to social issues. I mean, in the US, unions have practically disappeared, and corporations have had control over national policy that they haven't had since more than 100 years, since the Gilded Age. That affects wage growth and the returns to human capital, which is how we measure human capital. So here we see the in high-income OECD, in China, and in the upper middle-income countries, we see either constant shares of human capital and wealth or declining. And that is due to these factors, the aging of the population. You've got a smaller population. You don't have that demographic dividend, slow wage growth, and other things. But natural capital, that is still very important. Even though the share of wealth declines with development, down from 47% to something like 3% in high-income OECD countries, its value in per capita terms continues to grow. And the value is three times in high-income countries what it is in the low-income countries. So it's important to know that this is not just about depleting natural capital or trading off natural capital for other assets. Right? It's important that we maintain it, and it does stay quite important in all countries. Here we can look a little bit at a scatter plot and the trend lines. What we see in the bottom, the horizontal axis, it says change in total wealth. How is wealth growing over time? On the vertical axis, we see the change in renewable assets. Remember before I mentioned we distinguish the non-renewable, you extract them and they're gone. The renewable, if managed well, they can generate income forever. Our forests, agricultural land, water, fisheries, et cetera. So here we see, even for all the income groups, even the high income OECD countries, still, they're increasing the value of renewable natural capital as they grow, right? This is what we need for resilient growth. We don't want to deplete our natural capital. Some people have proposed that there's a trade-off, but it seems less so when we look at these data. Now, I had one of the things that we've done is develop this for specific countries. So this next section looks at one country in particular in a little bit more detail, that is Indonesia. So I wonder if there are any questions about the general approach or definitions that we might want to take before I go into this. If not, then I'll just go ahead.
I have a question. And it's about the, when you talk about this per capita wealth, it doesn't account for disparate distribution across the population.
Yes, that is a big issue for us. And unfortunately, you know, here we are limited to what's globally available, and we do not have information about distribution across all of our countries. There are groups that have done this for specific countries, and we have, when we've done some case studies or done a deep dive for some countries, we have pulled this in. But at this point, we're not able to do that. I mean, you can start to look at some of them if you look at agricultural land, you know, again, if we go down to the country level, but we're really constrained when we're trying to develop a global database. But it is absolutely a hugely important issue.
Yeah, thank you. I understand the constraints.
Anything else?
Yeah, I just have a quick question here with the previous slide, which you just talked about, and I think kind of the some of what the direction we're going. So appropriately, you're kind of saying appropriately managed natural capital and trying to find that balance can lead to resilient and sustainable growth. Is that
That's correct. That's correct. We want to use our natural capital, but be careful about where you deplete it.
Yeah, because you have to appropriately manage it for it to continue to be a renewable resource. You can't just chop down all of the old growth forests and expect them to still have the same ecosystem services.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
That's correct. Okay, anything else? No, okay. So when we start out, we look at, and by the way, also if there are, I know this is also kind of a research methods course. So if there are any questions about how we've actually developed the numbers for any of these things, I'd be happy to answer that too. We can take the conversation in that direction, because that is a main part, huge part of what we do, you know, figuring out how we can actually measure these consistently across countries with the kind of data that we have. Okay, so one of the things we do here, we're looking at East Asia Pacific, and you may recall our earlier slides, we had, you know, we just lumped them all together. We did pull out China, but you know, they were kind of lumped together. So if we look across these countries, and these of course are not all countries, but these are all countries that are included in our database. So Malaysia stands out. That's kind of on the cusp of being a high income country in terms of wealth per capita. It's still more than double that of China. And China, we see, is number two. It's ahead of many other countries, but still quite a ways in 2014. I'm sure it's increased quite a bit since then. Indonesia, our country of interest, is right in the middle there. And down at the very bottom is Vietnam and Cambodia, countries that have been growing very quickly, but starting from a relatively low base. Okay, so this helps us when, you know, I was meeting with the Ministry of Finance in Indonesia. They want to see, as I mentioned, you know, how do we compare to our neighbors? Where are we in this situation? So if we look more closely at Indonesia as a country, we can see in 2014 what the distribution of wealth was. 33% was produced capital, 20% natural capital, 50% was human capital. Net foreign assets here are negative, right? That means Indonesia is a net debtor. That's not necessarily a problem. There's no problem in borrowing money, as long as it's invested in a way that will generate income to repay it in the future. It's when you borrow money and it doesn't go into such investments that you end up in trouble. Okay, we can take a closer look at natural capital. And here we see that cropland is the largest component of natural capital at 44%, followed by pasture land at 5%. Fossil fuel energy and minerals are also very important there, 23% and 10%. And the forests and protected areas account for 18%. So this is the kind of more granular, and we can even go into more detail, particularly on forests now. We can look at timber plus three ecosystem services. But this is a more the granular picture that we can develop for every country. And then if we come back to this picture of, well, have countries been investing, but has it been enough to match their population growth? Well, look at Indonesia here and compare that to Cambodia, Laos PDR, and Vietnam. The light blue bar, remember that's the growth in total wealth, is not that high compared to many other countries in the region and far below China. And also its growth in per capita wealth is only about half. So, you know, Indonesia looking at this is saying, we could probably do better than some of our neighbors. However, Philippines, Papua New Guinea, and Solomons, they could say, well, you know, some countries have not even done as well as we have. So now, what is driving this change in wealth per capita? That would be the next question. Well, wealth changed, but how did it change? What different factors change? And how does that compare to other countries? So let's just look at the group of countries first. I mentioned that when we talk to, say, a Ministry of Finance, they want to know how they're doing compared to their neighbors. And sometimes they want to know neighbors that are similar to them, say in income or other kinds of natural capital endowment. Sometimes they like to look at what country they aspire to. So if you're a middle income country like Indonesia, you might aspire to become more like South Korea, which is a high income country. You could say, well, you know, they're in our region. I kind of understand them. And so, you know, that's kind of a model for us. In this, we're just looking more at countries that are similar to them, Vietnam, Philippines, Papua New Guinea, and then that whole group, combined group of the lower middle income. So here we see the light blue thick bar that crosses those colored ones tells us how much total wealth increased per capita across these countries and the lower middle income group. So, you know, Indonesia did pretty well compared to these countries. Then we look at how each of the components contributed. So for Indonesia, the one that stands out is that bright orange bar. What's that? That's the non-renewables. That's the fossil fuels and minerals. Okay, it's good. Wealth increased, but that poses certain challenges for development that they have to be very aware of. Others increased a bit, the renewables hardly at all, but some of their infrastructure, produced capital, their human capital didn't increase a lot. Let's compare that to Vietnam. Their accumulation of wealth was more balanced. Some was the non-renewables, some was the renewable natural capital, some was the infrastructure produced capital, and quite a bit in human capital. So that's a bit more of a balanced approach here. Philippines stands out for its non-renewables and human capital. Papua New Guinea was really in trouble. The only positive part of their wealth change was the non-renewables, the minerals, and fossil fuels. And finally, if we do overall a comparison with lower middle income countries, on average, they invested most in human capital and to some extent the produced capital and much less in natural capital and particularly the renewable natural capital as a group, it declined, which is a little bit worrying. Okay. If we take a look now, compare Indonesia to the countries it aspires to, what did it really want to achieve? Brazil and Korea are two good examples for them that they are always looking to see what could we do better. Indonesia increased its wealth by 42% per capita. Brazil, much less, only 24%, although it started off higher, so its per capita wealth was still high. Korea increased a great deal, almost doubling its per capita wealth. And a lot of investment in produced capital, in human capital, virtually none in the renewables. With Brazil, we saw some in the natural capital, mostly in human capital. So again, these are just the stories that we tell to try to put a country's data in perspective. And again, you know, it's something, whatever kind of research you're doing, whatever kind of analysis you're doing, always stop and think, well, how would some comparison help me make my story? How would it help me take this forward? So what about natural capital? Let's take a closer look at this. Here's Indonesia's natural capital and the change in value per capita. Forest down, protected areas somewhat down, cropland increased, pasture land somewhat down, oil increased, natural gas increased, coal increased, metals and minerals all increased. So we see it is mostly the non-renewables that have contributed, and to some extent, agriculture and cropland value. One of the questions that you want to ask then is, well, what about the land area and the value? Because there are different ways that wealth could increase when it comes to the renewable natural capital. You could extend agricultural land, extend the amount of land under cultivation, or you could make the existing quantity more profitable. You can do that by growing more valuable crops or by increasing productivity and reducing degradation. So what are sort of the different factors here? The blue bar, again, the light blue bar is the change in the asset value per capita. We've introduced something here because, again, you have to understand the role of population growth. Population growth will always dilute wealth per capita. So it is there in that yellow bar. What we want to look at is the orange, the land area, and that gray one, which is the value per square kilometer. With forests, there was a decline of forest area, a loss of forest area of about 15%. The value increased slightly, but not enough to counteract and compensate for the loss in area and the population dilution effect. With cropland, we saw both a big increase in the land area, almost a 50% increase in land under cultivation, and also a significant increase in the value. Pasture land, both the land area and the unit value declined. And protected areas increased, but the value per unit declined. So here we start to get into a little bit more of a nuanced picture. Naturally, if you're looking at a particular area, a subnational area, or even a project or a very local area, you could go into much more detail and understand the reasons behind this. Nevertheless, it's very important at the national level to provide this big picture view of what's going on that can then motivate this much more granular and detailed assessment into what's going on where. And one of the things that we would plan to include in the future is much more spatial analysis, disaggregation. So you can pinpoint, it was okay here, but maybe not there. And, you know, is that okay? You know, we don't want to say there should never be an increase in cropland, for example, or that we have to keep forests as they are right now. But you have to understand what the implications of that trade-off are. Okay, let me, now I'm going to go into something that is really very much macroeconomics. And Sabina, you have to give me some guidance whether we should do that, whether we want to have more questions or discussion or think about how this might relate more to the work that people are doing.
So how do people, what's the sense here of the group? Do you want to continue to go a little bit more into detail into accounting for natural capital at the national level, or do you want to turn more to Q&A? Come on, people, usually you're not shy.
I would say if there's existing content, we might as well share it.
Yeah, I think
so. I agree.
Okay.
Okay, keep going, Glenn Marie. I hear keep going.
Okay. now we're getting into the real economic stuff. So just by background, I am in the Environment, Natural Resources, and the Blue Economy Department of the World Bank. And one of our big challenges is always making our case to our macroeconomist colleagues, the kind of people who are in the Treasury Department and these people who are looking at the national economy, and they're saying, where is our revenue coming from and why should we care about sustainability? So one of the things that we try to do increasingly is bring this into the toolkit and indicators that our conventional economists use. What is it that they're used to thinking about and seeing, and how can we bring natural capital into that too, so that they can understand and make decisions that are informed by what's going on? So mostly what I've focused on so far is number one, the change in wealth per capita at the national level. And we're really promoting this as a sort of headline or dashboard indicator of sustainability. Now we're going to come to a couple of others. One is adjusted net national income, then which is like GDP adjusted for depletion and depreciation of assets. Adjusted net savings, and then something that's very specific to governments, which is their fiscal balance, the budget. So we look at this at the national level, but certainly can be done at the state level as well. They have to produce a fiscal balance. Basically, it's like revenues versus expenditures. Public sector balance sheet. This is wealth for the public sector, including natural resources, and then something called total factor productivity, which I will come to. That is a very important factor in how we increase our material well-being without having to use more inputs, how we get more out of what we're already using without using more stuff. Okay, so let's go to the adjusted net national income. Okay, GDP. GDP is growing. Good. Yes, we're happy. GDP is declining. No, we're unhappy. However, what about depreciation of our infrastructure, buildings, machinery, et cetera? We have to take that into account. What about depletion of natural capital? Here, the fossil fuels, the minerals, they're depleting. You can only use them once and then they're gone. Same with degradation of agricultural land, of forest, depletion of forest through cutting and no replanting. So we have to take that into account. And this was the figure for Indonesia over the 15 years we were interested in. The orange line is gross national income, which is the corresponds to GDP with some adjustments, and the blue line is adjusting it for this depreciation, depletion, and degradation. And you can see it's quite different.
For how do you account, like what's your mechanism to account for the depletion? Like how do you get that number to do the
So we look at each individual account. In this one, we're so far, we're only looking at forest timber and the minerals and fossil fuels. So for forest timber, what we have is an estimate from the UN's Food and Agriculture Organization, FAO, of forest land that's available for supplying timber and timber extraction. So within each country, we are able to estimate what is called the mean annual increment. And that is net growth of forests minus natural mortality. So the net growth is what would be available for harvesting without depleting the forest. So we measure what is that net growth from the mean annual increment against the reported timber harvest. If it's below, okay, we're fine. We're not depleting the forest. Never mind that at the national level, you could have local depletion versus, but at least at the national level, this is our initial assessment. Okay, what happens though, if you're harvesting more than what the forest is growing? In essence, you're treating it like a mine. And anything that's over a sustainable harvest is counted as depletion. Mm-hmm. So that's how we get it for timber. Anything over sustainable harvest, we take that away. Now with minerals and fossil fuels, it's all depletion. So that you have to take also, you have to take that off. And we have our ways. We do have a very detailed model that looks at mineral reserves extraction, the price of the minerals extracted, the costs of extracting, so that we use these figures to come up with the number. Anything, any more, any further questions? If not, I'll go to the next.
So it's kind of like with agriculture, looking at these forests like as if they're, you know, a piece of agriculture. You have to appropriately manage them. You have to appropriately harvest them. You can't just clear cut. You know, there has to be like sustainable levels of harvesting to continue that growth, to, if we're talking about just straight growth, to continue that resilient growth that you're talking about.
That's correct. You know, just as I said at the very beginning, you know, if a company wants to borrow money from the bank or someone, they have to show evidence of their income, but also their assets minus liabilities. Because if they sell off their assets, income goes up, but we know that won't last. And in essence, that's what happens when you're depleting forests. You're selling off your asset. Income, GDP, gross national income looks great this year, but what's going to happen in the future? Right? So that's why we have to say you can't count that as income. That's just running down your assets. Okay. Adjusted net savings. This is another, this is an indicator that a lot of our economists, conventional economists, departments of treasury or ministries of finance really like, because this is telling us out of your income this year, you know, how much did you actually save and invest? What is adding to your wealth? Or did you add to your wealth? Or was it just depletion? So what do? We start with gross national savings. This is a figure every country produces. You could even think of it for your own self. You know, how much do you save every year? Then you have to subtract what's called consumption of fixed capital. You know, every area, every discipline has its own technical terminology, which might not always make sense. But what this means is, okay, you've got capital goods, you've got buildings, you've got infrastructure. They depreciate, they wear down over time. They're not going to last forever and ever. You have a car, it might last 10 years. So that means every year you lose some of that value. So you have to take that off. So this is an example of a country that started off with gross national savings around 17-18%. A lot was reduced by the depreciation just of produced capital, stuff that we measure ordinarily. So that brings it down, brings your wealth and savings and what you can add to wealth down to 3-4% of national income, which is a pretty low amount. But on the other hand, you're investing in human capital by spending on education. You're putting money into the education sector, and that contributes to building human capital long-term. So that raises this savings rate up to, in this case, somewhere between 8% and 9%. But now we have to subtract from that the depletion of natural capital, whether it's the non-renewables, minerals and energy, or forest timber. And once you take that down, it brings savings way down to -6% or -7%. We also include a very, in this case, it's a very small amount, but it's important, which are the pollution damages to human capital. And this country ends up with negative savings of about -8%. So, you know, this is not a good situation. This is a situation where you're basically using up your capital instead of building it. So adjusted net savings is another indicator that comes out of this work that we use to communicate with our colleagues, our conventional economists, the ministries of finance and planning and so on. Okay, this is the concept of adjusted net national savings. And this is how it looks for Indonesia. Okay, so the solid blue line at the very top, that's their gross national savings. And they're showing fairly high savings, over 20% for quite a few years. The years here have sort of fallen out, but basically 2001 to 2016. The broken black line shows the adjusted net savings. That is, it takes gross national savings and subtracts the consumption of fixed capital, adds education, investment in human capital, subtracts the depletion of natural capital. And what we see is in the early part, up until around 29, 2010 or so, adjusted net savings was negative. And that means it was basically using up its capital. It did become positive, more positive in more recent years. So again, this is the story that we tell about what is going on in the economy. Some of the other macroeconomic indicators I've mentioned, the fiscal balance, or gross, which is our gross operating balance adjusted for natural resources revenues. So here the idea is that the non-renewable resources generate revenues to government, these royalties they're often called, but those are not going to be permanent. Those are actually depletion, and they shouldn't be counted as income. So here's, this is the proposal was actually first made by our colleagues in the International Monetary Fund that we should be adjusting. Don't report the fiscal balance with the mineral revenues, the natural resource revenues on the revenue side. They are really not permanent. They're depletion. They should be out of there. So that is one of our indicators, and we have, as I'll show in a minute, done this for Indonesia. Public sector balance sheet, including natural resources. If we include them as assets, then when we deplete them, we show this. We show that, well, your wealth is declining. You've used up this asset. So it's a better way to keep track of this. And total factor productivity, which I'll come to. So conventional fiscal balance, mineral fiscal revenues are income, but actually they're derived by selling off your assets. So you don't want to count this as income. Okay. And here is what we get. This was some early information. So the top line, which is green, is the conventional fiscal balance for Indonesia. And already you can see on the scale on the left-hand side, it was negative. That is not a good thing. Not something that a country can maintain, a government can maintain in the long term. Whether it's a municipal government or a national government, your balance has to be balanced. And hopefully you're actually saving something. Your balance is positive for those years when things are tough, like this year, and your revenues have suddenly disappeared. a rainy day fund. But here, in this particular case, not only was the conventional balance starting off in 2010 negative, but it was declining. If we look at that sort of yellowish orange line below it, then we see it's an even more difficult situation, at least in the early years, that that fiscal balance was really being maintained by these mineral revenues, something that is not, it is not sustainable in the long term. They kept this conventional fiscal balance going by selling off assets. It improved in more recent years, but again, it's important to keep track of this.
What was the improvement? Like, what was the, specifically in Indonesia, like what made this start to, the bottom line, what was the change that made this start to go up?
I'm not 100% sure because it's been a few years since I was there, but I actually think it was a decline in revenues, not that from minerals and energy. And it basically, but you see the conventional balance started to level off, which meant they started to rely on other sources of revenue. Some of the things that they did that were actually quite important was they used to heavily subsidize energy use. And it was just an enormous drain on the budget. There are some countries where the subsidies for use of fossil fuels account for a third of government's budget. And most of that goes to the high-income residents who have personal cars and are driving around a lot. You know, there are a lot of ways you could you could subsidize public transportation without subsidizing polluting fossil fuel use. So I know one of the things that happened here to help improve the fiscal balance was that they got rid of a lot of their fossil fuel subsidies. Mm-hmm. But there may be some other things too, but I don't remember the details. But these are exactly the kinds of questions that are important. And, you know, you show people this kind of stuff and then, you know, our policymakers start to put this picture together and see sometimes you want to subsidize some things, but you've got to understand the trade-off, both in the short term, what you subsidize one thing rather than the other, and then what the long-term implications are. Are you selling off the assets? What are you going to do 10 years from now, 20 years from now? Public sector balance sheet, again, this is something that our colleagues at the IMF did. This was an experimental thing. Someone asked earlier, I think it was Dina, asked about the distribution of wealth, if we had any information about that, which we don't. But one of the things that's helpful is to look at the public sector. So if we can at least start to split up what belongs to the private sector, what belongs to the public sector, then we can focus more on that private sector, households, businesses, what households by income group, et cetera. So building this public sector balance sheet also helps then with the fiscal balance. It sort of complements this. And so they did propose, here are the assets. In most countries, except for the United States, mineral revenues, anything under the ground, including water, belongs to the state. In essence, it belongs to all citizens and the government manages it on behalf of the citizens. Only in the United States, and there's one other country which I can't remember, I don't know, Sabine, if you do, do resources under the ground belong to the person who owns the surface, right? So in this country, the government ownership of oil, gas, et cetera, is only on public lands. That is not the case in any other country, except for the one I can't remember. So anyway, putting this on the public sector balance sheet is very important. And then finally, one other thing that I want to mention, did I have this here? Sorry, I have to make sure that I got to the total factor productivity. Oh, okay. Well, this we're back to the public sector balance sheet. And again, this is just a graphic display of the point I was making. If you have mineral resources, they're going to generate cash for government. And you have two choices. You can use it for salaries, for spending. You can use it for transfers. Or you can invest in assets, or you can do a combination of the two. If you take the spending it on subsidy, salaries, and transfers, your net worth is reduced, right? You're depleting minerals, not building anything in its place. If you invest it in other assets, you're compensating for that loss, and you're not reducing the asset base of the economy. And I think this is what we had here for Indonesia, but because it's getting late, I'm going to jump ahead. This is just an example here. Total factor productivity, understanding drivers of growth. As I mentioned before, what we really want to see is material well-being, but minimizing the use of inputs, minimizing the use of material inputs, of the pollution that comes out of it, et cetera. So one of the things that economists do is look at how growth occurs and how that growth is explained by the assets that go into it. Produce capital, labor, human capital are the two that they've always looked at. But we have done some work based on OECD, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, to bring natural capital into the picture. I mean, you think about it for a minute. Does it make sense to look at total factor productivity in agriculture without including agricultural land? No. So this work adds this so that we can see, has there been real growth in terms of more efficient use, more productive use of our assets, all the assets? And if so, which ones have contributed the most? So here we have total factor productivity. These are just a selected group of countries. Both the light blue line is the conventional total factor productivity. The dark blue line is when we've included natural resources in the picture. And we do see that it does make quite a difference for some countries. In some cases, including natural resources actually boosts the apparent productivity, whereas in others, it means that its total factor productivity is less. What that means is if it reduces is it means you've been really inefficient in the use of natural capital. If it increases, it's like, whoa, it's been much more efficient use of natural capital than of human capital and produced capital. So I think this is just the example for Indonesia. This is the annual average growth. And I think, is this one? Yeah, so this is a useful one because it does break down what the contributions are. In China, the labor or human capital was a very small component of total factor productivity. Produced capital was very important. Natural capital, not so much. And that those were the ones that really contributed a great deal. I think we're just about finished now.
Hey. So
let me thank you for sticking through. I know you're not all economics majors, so I hope it wasn't too tedious and hope that it was useful and gives you something to think about.
Thank you, Glenn Marie. Can you get out of screen sharing so we can see better? That's great. So first of all, let's give Glenn Marie a hand here. Thank you for a great summary of how not just the important role of natural capital, but how natural capital and human capital and produced capital really interplay. And, you know, as we always say in my ecological economics course, if we don't pay attention to that, we're in trouble because the natural capital in one form or another is going to be around. The question is it going to be useful for humans and how can we turn it into productive capital? So questions. comments? Floor is open.
I appreciate your presentation. Thank you. I had two quick questions. One was, you mentioned about how increase in population dilutes. And then, so I was looking, or then I think you mentioned, so this, my question is about the distinction in that increase in population, and then how that's measured as far as human capital, the increase in human capital. I'm thinking it has to do with the educational investment, but if you could clarify that, that would be really helpful.
Sure. Sabina, do you want to maybe take a couple questions and then
if
there's more than one? Otherwise, I'll go on with this.
I have another one.
Sure.
Go ahead, Gail.
Just a general question. I used to work in development, and you know, there's an interesting relationship between development organizations and the World Bank, and the provision that the bank and the international banking system puts on, particularly on developing countries, right? And the requirements for them to qualify for capital and that kind of thing. So there is a place, you know, and we're in, you know, where the ecology and that part of it, of course, we know needs to be preserved. And then there's another part where that may be the only capital, or, you know, one of the few resources or ways that a country can actually develop. And so if the rules are too stringent, and understanding that, you know, that may be implemented in order to preserve the ecology, but then the country actually does not develop, you know, and winds up mired in this, you know, just circle of just not being able to break out and actually grow.
That's right.
So just your perspective on that.
Okay. Well. So here's one of the things that we often hear. The West grew rich by depleting its capital, along with the natural capital of many other countries. Why shouldn't we do the same? Okay, so the question is, that's not quite the question, or part of the answer is, if you deplete natural capital, make sure you invest it, right? That you compensate for the loss. When it's the non-renewables, you only get one chance. If you spend it on one of the things that we see in our resource-rich countries is civil service expands tremendously, and right before election, everyone gets a salary increase. That is not helpful for the majority of the people in the long run. So it's how you manage the revenues that's important, not that things shouldn't be spent at all. And the same is true with the renewable. You know, one of the things we didn't have time to really go into it, but one of the trade-offs is between forest land and agricultural land, right? So, you know, populations are growing, people need land to grow food. Where are they going to go? They're going to go to the forest. So again, you know, you got to think about it. It's not that there shouldn't be any trade-offs, but understand what the long-term economic impact of it is, and also the environmental, because we know that we reach certain tipping points with the environment, and the whole thing could collapse if you get to a certain point. So, you know, one of the things that a lot of our countries have discovered, Kenya, for example, rapid expansion of agricultural land into forests, and they started to affect what's called the water tower. And that is the forest land that provides almost all the water for the country. And since then, having real serious water shortages, Malawi definitely had the same problem. And now they're trying to build back the forest because of realizing how important it is providing water. So this is the kind of thing, you know, we're trying to learn. It's a very complex interaction among these different ecosystems. So another thing that happened in Rwanda, relying on hydropower quite a bit and expanding agricultural land into the forest without realizing that the forests were playing a critical role in maintaining the hydropower. Why? Not so much the water flow, though that was important, but it retained sediment. And agricultural land, when you have really heavy rains as they have, all the soil runs off, it clogs up your dams, and you have no energy. So these are the things. Yes, people need to use what they have. That's very clear, but use it in a way that will guarantee that prosperity increases over time and you're not trading off short-term gain for long-term pain.
Right, but it's a hard decision to make when you're in a subsistence
Absolutely.
Economy in that moment. So the policy and that long vision has to be kind of implemented in a different way to make sure that the in the moment decisions don't have those long-term implications.
Absolutely, and you know, it's not all just one or the other. So for example, when it comes to oil revenues, the state of Alaska has a very interesting system. Their revenues come to the state. They have two ways of dealing it. Some of it is paid out as a dividend. A certain portion is paid out as a dividend to all of its citizens every year. Another portion maintains their state investment fund. So whatever, if you have like depletion or loss or inflation, you have to adjust your investment fund for that. And then anything left over is distributed, given to its population. So, you know, there are a lot of, kind of mixed policies to try to achieve both of these. And that trade-off between short-term and long-term, look, I mean, it makes sense. People will starve in the short-term. Even if they might few do better in the long term, and one has to take that into account.
Mark, did you have a question? No?
Yes, I had a question.
Go ahead.
So we were talking about countries that are, you know, we would consider, I guess, moving from subsistence to, like, you know, the what you know, some of the indicators that we were looking at with you know, the world, the economists that kind of lead the policies, the global policies. But with like the US, I guess we would be considered a strong, or you're talking about stagnation and like the indicators that could lead to declines. But it looks like if you want to make it, like, if you look at it circularly, and if you invest, if you kind of offset to reset the balances, you invest in natural capital, you invest in reforestation, you invest in sustainable agriculture, you start, I guess, nurturing and caring for your, you know, ecosystems and kind of bringing them back, that could create, that could rebound, create the balance where you can then push towards more sustainable and, like, this, like, I guess, sustainable growth model. Is that, like, it seemed like...
Absolutely. Yeah, no, absolutely. Yeah, it's very important to do that.
Okay, we have one...
There's another question. I'm sorry, Gail's first question.
Okay.
So think about it this way. Suppose... I'm trying to think of the best example. It's the population dilution is related to partly to human capital, but to the others as well. Think about a country with a fixed land area. If the population keeps growing and growing and growing, how much is available for each person to farm on? It gets smaller and smaller. So the ability to grow your own food gets to be less and less and less. So that's one aspect of the population dilution. Certainly human capital is another, in this possibly, but even things like our infrastructure. You know, you've got roads, you've got highways, you've got public transport, et cetera. You've got a water supply system. If you've got more people, the ability to get the services, the roads get more crowded, public transport is more crowded, so your service from that capital good is reduced. So the challenge here is to see population growth as the potential demographic dividend, but that requires real serious investment in education. in building human capital, and as well as your other assets.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hey, I think we're at the end of our time. So Glenn-Marie, again, thank you so much. Dr. Lange from the World Bank, for spending your time with us today to talk about natural capital and wealth, counting for wealth and including your assets. So thank you all for participating, for your questions. I will see you next month, same link, when we're going to talk about post-industrial urban development. And I hope to see you then on February 19th. And again, Glenn-Marie, thank you. You're terrific. This was a great presentation. We appreciate it.
Okay, great. Well, thank you all very much. And again, I really admire, you know, your persistence and managing creatively with this crazy system.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I see you. If I don't see you in class next week,
thank you.
Next month in the seminar. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Hi, thank you.